welcome to the vote. Today I'm joined by Phelim Mac Cafferty, who is the leader of the Green Group on Brighton and Hove City Council. Good evening, Phelim. Let's talk about the Green Party generally first off. A lot of people have heard of you, but they don't really know the state of the party. So how are you doing locally and how are you doing nationally?
Currently we have, of the 54 councillors on Brighton and Hove, we have 11 of those councillors. Obviously we have Caroline Lucas, who's our only MP. We have a few MEPs and we have hundreds of councillors all over the country as well, and hopefully lots more in a few weeks' time as the local elections pan out in all of the London boroughs and in a number of the county elections as well.
You're aiming for a council member in every constituency, I read.
Correct, yes.
Right, that's pretty good. Across Europe, I mean, we think of the Green Party probably starting in Germany. I think of it back in those sort of CND days. Is that the genesis of the party?
Yeah, to some degree, that we still have a very strong party in Germany. We still run a number of the federal governments in Germany. We were briefly part of the government once again, previously with Merkel, when we formed a grand coalition, the so-called Jamaica coalition, with them. And to some degree, that defines where they are as a party. They're quite well established. Of course, they've got a much, much fairer voting system in Germany, which helps them do that. Sadly, way back at the 1989 European elections in this country, when, if you remember, Chernobyl happened, the Green Party had its highest ever vote, but at that point we were still electing our MEPs through the first-past-the-post system, and sadly we weren't able to avail of the quantity of MEPs at that time that we probably should have had, and that's where I think we lost out as one of the European parties, because the others, because of their fairer voting systems, are just that bit more established and have slightly more influence.
You're strong than we in do. Brussels, and I guess you want to stay strong in Brussels.
Of course we do.
The voting system in the UK is not good. I know you campaigned very strongly on it before. Despite that, obviously in Brighton you have taken control of the council not too long back. You know, you were in control, and you're still very influential, as you just said. So what achievements locally do you think the Greens have been responsible for? What things have you actually done for Brighton?
A whole series of things. Last week, for example, I was at the topping out ceremony, the sort of start of the formal process by which a building is established on Circus Street. And that was one of many, many different schemes that came forward under the Greens because of the sort of vision that we had of building, how we described it, building a better Brighton and Hove. To that end, we committed to a whole series of schemes. We helped get the new hospital, which everyone will obviously be aware of. We put in place the plan for Valley Gardens at the bottom of West Street. People will know that
the development
at the bottom of West Street there is the new development there as well. And if you follow right through from the I-360 along the seafront, all of that regeneration, that again was something that we committed to. So I think there's concrete and real things that people can see as evidence of Greens being in local government.
Concrete and crane seems to be the words that you're choosing.
Correct, okay. but also a series of other commitments that you may not be able to see.
Okay.
For example, we established an air quality zone where we were beginning to monitor air quality and where we were beginning to take tougher action. And we worked with the bus company on retrofitting some of their buses. So we were beginning to take the strong action that we need locally. As we all know, it's turning into a public health crisis that seems to have no end, sadly, at the moment. But that was one of the many things that we were able to commit to that maybe someone can't see or isn't so obvious.
So what do you those are the achievements, that's great. What do you further want to happen? What are your big aims, your big policies locally that are perhaps different to the others or maybe even the same? What ones do you want to see? What are the key things for the Greens in the next few years?
I think some of the things that we put forward as proposals at council meetings describe perfectly who we are and what our values are. For example, to that end, we put forward a proposal in the autumn about phasing out single-use plastics, and only at a council meeting last week we were able to put an amendment, put a proposal to full council again, that event organisers would have to not use single-use plastics as a part of their licence for the event. So your viewers will be aware of the fact that even though the City Council said to the Brighton Marathon, we want to work with you to lessen the quantity of single-use plastics that you use, and to that end, jugs and paper cups were used, great. Sadly, there were still huge amounts of plastic bottles that were brought into the city. And if you talk to groups like the Brighton Swimmers, after the Brighton Half Marathon, they were finding plastic bottles in the sea weeks and weeks later. And for them, this is a big, big, big issue. And many, many other people in the city are becoming aware of the issue, not least because of the wonderful Blue Planet 2 programme from David Attenborough that was on in the autumn and just reminded us of the magic of our marine life and why we have to do more for it. So that's one of the proposals as it stands. That's on something that you might expect the Greens to be passionate about, the environment. We're also passionate about ending the housing crisis. My colleague David Gibson has been leading on a whole series of proposals. The one that probably has captured some of your viewers' imagination has been the proposal to have a night shelter all year round. And we were delighted to see the Brighton Centre, us pinning our nail to the flag, as it were, and saying, OK, we'll lead from the front. And we were really disappointed when that came to an end and actually held a small protest as a way of saying, hold on a minute, we're not too happy about that. But ending that housing crisis and really intervening in what seems for far too many people in the city like an inescapable problem is another way that we really want to make a mark in the city.
Right. People on the left of the Labour, well, probably most people in the Labour Party, but want to get rid of homelessness as well, but particularly, I suppose, those on the left have been advocating similar policies to yours. There's not a lot between you and the left of the Labour Party, or is there? What differentiates you?
What's
the key things?
I think if we can, we will, of course, work with Labour, and we do all over the country where possible. And one of the things that we did when we were about to take the administration in 2011 was we turned around to Labour and said, let's run the council together. Let's make sure that this is a coalition that means that we have steady governance and we can run this place together. Sadly, Labour refused on that occasion, and at the last elections we said, we wish you well, but we want to work with you where possible. So I believe that we've been quite propositional to that end, and I know that some of your viewers will be aware of the electoral alliance that we proposed, and once again we were kind of told where to go on that one. And that's,
is that nationally, you mean?
Yes. Yeah. And that's fine. That's the priority of the Labour Party. That's completely fine. We will work with them. Of course we will, against Tory austerity, but I suppose our point is that Labour councils around the country simply aren't doing enough. They're not standing up and shouting enough about the ill effects of austerity and how dreadful budget cuts have been to local government. Nationally and locally, yeah, we will work with them.
Yeah.
But we are different, to come back to your question. We fundamentally view the world in a different way. We would see the Labour Party is quite authoritarian, it's very centrist, it's about a sort of totem pole of one leader, whereas we see our very strength from as a grassroots party, we see our very strength as being about the members, to the members, for the members, not about leaders with autocued speeches and the sort of things that we came to associate far too readily with the last Labour government, of people being sort of messaged about the way that they should be conducting themselves. So we see ourselves very much as being about local parties deciding all over the country what their priorities are, and to that end, that's exactly what we do.
Talking of leaders, you've obviously got a pretty effective leader, or two actually, haven't you? Although more people will know of one in particular, Caroline Lucas, who's a MP in Brighton. Labour on the council seem likely to have a new leader, probably today. time of broadcast, time of recording this. I'm not sure who that is, but we've got a good idea.
We do.
Before, in the second half, we're going to talk about maybe local politics and how things might change with a new Labour leader. But I just wondered, you were saying there were difficulties with Labour in Brighton over the last few years. Warren Morgan's been the leader. What's your view of him and the relationship between the Greens and Labour over the last couple of years?
I think Warren has been part of what I would understand as the bed of the Labour Party locally that's on the way out. That is for far too long sort of described who Labour are locally, if you include people like Steve Bassam and all of those people, that they very consciously in the 1980s entered local government and drove out who they saw as the militants, and they wanted Labour to be understood as a serious centrist sort of organisation. And from that point of time onwards, they've rallied around progress.
We'll have to carry on with this in the second half, so join us after these adverts. Thank you for joining us back on The Vote, and I'm joined by Phelim Mac Cafferty, who's the leader of the Greens on Brighton and Hove City Council. Phelim, we were just talking about the Labour leadership in Brighton and Hove. It was getting interesting. We had to stop for a second. Let's carry on, though. You were telling me about Warren Morgan, and it seems likely, does it not, that Daniel Yates is going to be the new leader of Brighton and Hove City Council.
I think it's less an election and more a coronation.
More a coronation.
He was the only candidate, as far as I understand.
As far as we know, yeah.
And I think he's going to try very hard to draw the two halves of the party back together, as it were.
The unifying candidate.
As it were, I believe so, because Warren, of course, was essentially, he was ousted by the grassroots movement of the left wing, organising around the momentum.
Was it that? Because, we had Mark Turner on from the GMB, and he was saying actually it was the same wing as Warren comes from that was trying to sort of maybe lose Warren because they thought they could stay in control with a different candidate but with the same message.
If you actually look at Warren's own tweets on the subject, he recalls that in the autumn, the three constituency Labour parties sat down with him and basically said, you go or we push.
Yeah.
And from that end, I'm not sure what you would describe that as. I think that is described as an ousting or a bit of a helpful push. But I suppose now is the time to kind of talk about what the next 6 to 12 months look like.
And under Daniel, what will it look like?
Well, from my point of view, and he has been the chair of the Health and Wellbeing Board. He's a health professional himself. I've tried to pin him down, and I did so last week at full council on where Labour stand in relation to the proposed privatisation of the National Health Service. Your viewers may have seen some of this described as the sustainable transformation plans. Others in other bits of the country, they're described as accountable care organisations. Either way, it's from the proposals of the Secretary of State for Health, Jeremy Hunt. He's saying there's a massive deficit. We need to cut. And to that end, this is what happens to the NHS in the future. And I've tried several times, and the Green Group of councillors have tried to put forward proposals saying, why doesn't Labour locally do what other Labour councillors are doing up and down the country, and saying very adamantly, hold on a minute, we're going to have nothing to do with privatisation of the National Health Service. To that end, Daniel hasn't been forthcoming, either being very effective or indeed very clear about where Labour stand with regard to privatisation of the National Health Service, and that has been something that despite running after him, kind of saying, where do you stand? We've not actually had clarity on where they do stand.
His supporters, obviously, in Labour in Brighton will obviously be very keen on that. And we were just talking just before about what he could do. Rumours around, I think I said to you, are that Nancy Platt may well be promoted. She's only been on the council a few months, but she's an influential figure in Brighton Labour politics, always has been. And that would be presumably to to keep Momentum on board because she's close to Momentum. Do you go along with that?
And again have the big tent theory to politics.
Inclusive?
That you bring the people who might be most adversarial, especially in a whipped party like Labour, you try and bring them as close as you can to the centre of the action to try and keep them loyal to the project.
So the next year will be a big test. If he can do it and bring the party together, then they could sweep the Greens away. No,
I don't think they will.
Okay.
I don't think they will for a number of reasons.
Yeah.
If you look at a number of the decisions that they've made while they've been in power, if you look at Hove Library,
yep,
a disaster. Again, last week at full council, they have tried to put forward proposals that will, in effect, begin the closure of Hove Library. They didn't learn from the campaign where 4,500 people signed my petition to stop flogging off Hove Library.
That was a significant win for you and for Robert Nemeth, I guess.
Yeah, and the Conservatives, to be fair, came on board. Robert, okay, to be fair, was one of the Conservatives who got the significance of Hove Library. But over Hove Library, they've repeatedly said things about the way that they want to run the City Council as well, which some of your viewers might be wondering, well, mm-hmm, what has that got to do with anything? But that would, in essence, they want to return to the cabinet system. When the Greens were in power, we changed the governance to the committee system, which means that if you're a backbencher or the leader of a group, you have the same say because it's a fairer form of governing the City Council.
Yeah.
Labour have said they will return to the cabinet system, and the cabinet system essentially gives 10 people all the power and all the say over virtually everything. And if you look at a number of the proposals that have come forward from Labour over the last number of years, it has been through the successful intervention of the opposition parties at committees that things have been stopped, like the sale of the Downland, which I know is so precious and so important to us as a city, not least to protect our water, because the Downland protects the chalk aquifers, but also it acts as a place where we can go and seek leisure and seek retreat from the city as well. So I believe firmly that if Labour did run the next council and they ran it with majority control, we would have a cabinet system within weeks.
Mm.
We would then have Hove Library flogged and we would have the Downland sold off. And I think for those reasons alone, Labour won't form an outright majority on the City Council.
You have one big ally, of course. Caroline Lucas is very, very popular personally. Is she going to be campaigning a lot locally in the local elections?
I believe she will. She's been.
That would help you a lot, wouldn't it?
Around the country in the last number of weeks, not least supporting her co-leader, Jonathan Bartley, in London Borough of Lambeth elections, where he hopes to join the one council that we have on Lambeth Council. He was very effective in opposing another Labour council trying to sell off a Carnegie Library.
Also doing things with housing estates. They wanted to knock a few down, didn't
correct,
they, in Lambeth?
Yes.
And perhaps put in private housing and stuff. I mean, it seemed a bit odd, a bit of an own goal, I would have thought, actually. It was sadly
matched by a number of the other Labour authorities.
Yeah.
Southwark had an infamous example where that they knocked down an entire council site, which of course is affordable social homes, and proposed a new development, and of over 1,000 homes were only proposing that, I believe it was 17, were affordable. So sadly, a number of the Labour councils within the M25 have done pretty damaging things, and I think from that point of view we'll be able to make inroads in those places in the next few weeks.
Okay, while we're talking about Caroline, I wondered why she hasn't had the same effect as, Nigel Farage. You know, the Greens are of the same sort of size as UKIP, in fact, probably got more votes. Correct me if I'm wrong. Farage has been on Question Time and on the BBC almost every, hourly. And Caroline hasn't been able to achieve that. I mean, do you blame the BBC? Or is Farage UKIP just right-wing Tories? I know this is just a bit philosophical, but what's your view on the whole sort of, UKIP thing? I mean, they've been so successful, haven't they? Why have they managed to achieve this? Or are they just last vestige of the British Empire, for instance?
I think to some degree, because they have not at all said back to the British people that we need facts to actually populate the sort of sensible discussions that we need to have about the sort of future country, Europe, world that we want in the future. They've essentially been at the very core of the don't trust the specialists, who are these specialists, that we saw pan out so disastrously at the Brexit referendum. And I think to that end, if all that you're after is sort of populist stance on you know, a populist positioning where everything is the European Union's fault, when in actual fact drill into the problem and actually a whole series of things are actually this country's own approach to problems. For example, UKIP talk endlessly about the Commons fishery policy, but actually there's a whole load of the policies around how the UK interprets that policy that actually have far more to do with UK government rules and laws than about Europe. But despite that, UKIP have been able to sell sort of populist approach. And I suppose that will be good for Daily Mail headlines, and it will be good for the sort of three-second response that BBC will want for a TV programme like Question Time. And to that end, I suppose I will attach some culpability to the BBC and the sort of editorial decisions or political decisions that they're making about who appears in their shows.
Screens should be on more, shouldn't they?
Well, we should be as a proportion of the vote, but also I would make the same argument that so should Plaid, so should the SNP, even the Liberals should be on a little bit more than they are currently.
It's still a bit centrist.
And to some degree, yeah. I think the BBC has actually moved since the Brexit vote. That I think they've moved a bit further to the centre right as well, actually. So, and I think that's been a problem.
Although, in quite liberal as well, Paris Lees being on Question Time a few weeks ago, you know, LGBT stuff being considered.
Oh, occasionally there are absolute gems on there, of course, and you know that we sit at home and share them, of course.
Yeah.
But for us personally, and in terms of who are routinely promoted through the programming of Question Time, I believe that the BBC have. I think the facts speak for themselves, that UKIP have been on a lot more than they proportionately should have been in terms of the percentage vote.
Thank you very much for coming on The Vote today. We'll definitely get you back on, so it'll be a very interesting discussion. Join us again soon on The Vote.